على آله وصحبه أجمعين. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ونبيه ورسوله، وأشهد أن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله تعالى، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. We begin the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All praise and glory belongs to Allah, Lord of the worlds. And we testify that no one is worthy of worship but Allah alone without any partners. And that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was his servant and his messenger. And the seal of his prophets. And the most noble of the carriers of his message. The noblest of his message. The Qur'an to humanity. Allah azza wa jalla says about the Qur'an, كتاب أنزلناه إليك مبارك ليتدبروا آياته وليتذكر أولو الألباب. A book we have revealed to you, O Muhammad, that is blessed. We revealed it to you so that they may reflect on its verses and so the people of understanding may remember. And he said, سبحانه وتعالى وننزل من القرآن ما هو شفاء. And we send down from this Quran that which is a cure and a mercy for the believers. And he said, subhanahu wa ta'ala, فَلَا أُقْسِمُ بِمَوَاقِعِ النُّجُومِ وَإِنَّهُ لَقَسَمٌ لَوْ تَعْلَمُونَ عَظِيمٌ إِنَّهُ لَقُرْآنٌ كَرِيمٌ فِي كِتَابٍ مَكْنُونٌ لَا يَمَسُّهُ إِلَّا الْمُطَهَّرُونَ تَنْزِيلٌ مِنْ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. Rather, I swear by the stations of the stars. And they, it isn't a swear, an oath. If you but knew, that is indeed great. What am I swearing about? That this is truly a noble book, a noble recital, a noble Qur'an, in a preserved tablet that is not touched except by those that are purified. It is a revelation from the Lord of the world, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the Qur'an is a cure from Allah and a mercy from Allah and a book wherein there is no doubt, a guidance for the pious. And it is a recital from the Lord of the worlds and a rope extended to us between Allah Azza wa Jal and His slaves. Whomever holds on to it is saved, and whomever refuses to hold on to it is finished, is lost. And that's why we wish, inshaAllah Azza wa Jal, in these next few gatherings, our Saturday nights, to dedicate them to the chapters of the Qur'an or the surahs of the Qur'an that we recite most frequently. But we have never come in touch with the reality of their meanings and what they entail and what we should be taking from them or reflecting on regarding them. Or we have lost touch with them. So we will begin with the concise surahs of the Qur'an from the end, from Surah An-Nas 114, going upwards towards the beginning, to come across as much of these surahs as Allah permits, so that we can stand in front of Allah differently and speak to Allah differently and listen to the speech of Allah Azza wa Jalla differently for the better, inshaAllah. So I wish to begin with Surah An-Nas and Surah Al-Falaq today, this evening, inshaAllah, some of their meanings and their virtue and their benefits and some lessons therein. And these two surahs are known as Al-Mu'awwidhatayn, right? The two chapters through which refuge, protection is sought. And actually, قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدٍ and قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ الْفَلَقِ and قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ النَّاسِ. So Al-Nas and Al-Falaq and Al-Ikhlas are called Al-Mu'awwidhat, those chapters by which protection is sought. For a reason that you will come to know by the end of the lecture. But especially the last two, they're paired together, even to the degree that they came down together, and that's why we are going to mention them together, inshaAllah. Al-Falaq and Al-Nas. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. In the name of Allah, the most merciful. Ar-Rahim means the bestower of mercy, or the deliverer of mercy. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ الْفَلَقِ. Say, قُلْ, meaning who? Meaning the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the ummah after him. أَعُوذُ, I seek protection, or I seek refuge. العود, that word for refuge, it literally means to come close to someone or something to be protected by it. That's why it's translated as refuge, because you come into your home close within its walls to be protected by its walls, right? You ever seen that little fish that always swims wherever the shark goes so nobody can touch it? Those little fish that always swim next to the sharks? That's isti'ala on a marine biology level. Understood? On an oceanic level, in the oceans. So, قُلْ أَعُوذُ, say, I am seeking refuge, meaning I'm running to Allah, being close to Allah, meaning with my heart. I'm clinging on to Him with my heart. That is what isti'adha is. Say, أَعُوذُ, I seek refuge, بِرَبِّ الْفَلَقِ, بِرَبِّ, by the Lord, by the Master, of al-falaq, translated as daybreak. Falaq literally means break. Falaqa means to split, to break, to crack. Some of the scholars said al-falaq means the daybreak. It's understood, the Lord of the break, the day when it breaks, meaning what? Sunrise. Understood? Daybreak, when the dawn comes, and then it gets brighter and brighter and brighter, the day is breaking. Right? So at dawn, moving on to the day. That's the daybreak. When the light of the morning breaks the darkness of the sky, the horizontal light that is fetched, and then the sun comes up from that same line, the disk of itself, that's called sunrise. Other scholars, the reason why the scholar said it means daybreak is because elsewhere in the Qur'an, from that you can take a hint as to how the scholars of the Qur'an interpret the Qur'an. The Qur'an interprets itself. In other places in the Qur'an, Allah Azza wa calls Himself Faliqul Isbah, the one who breaks open the morning. That's why Al-Falaq means the daybreak, the break open of the morning. Other scholars said, Rabbil Falaq, the Lord of the break, means the one who breaks open the seed for the plant to come out. You know the seeds when they germinate, right? When they get wet and moist and it cracks open and the roots go downward and the stem comes upward, correct? That starts how? That starts with a break in the seed. Why did they say Rabbul Falaq means that? Because Allah Azza wa Jalla said elsewhere in the Quran, Faliqul Habbi, inna Allah Faliqul Habbi wa Nawa. Indeed, certainly Allah is the Faliq, Falaqa, the one who breaks open the Hab, which is the seed that you plant, and the Nawa, which is the pit of the day. Same thing, right? Also planted. So, which of these two opinions is correct? That's another lesson, by the way, of tafsir, of Quranic interpretation. That whenever there's two, three, four, five meanings about a verse, oh my God, so how am I supposed to figure out which one is right? Who said you have to pick one? When there are multiple meanings of a verse that don't contradict one another, that you're supposed to understand from that it means all of them. There's no reason why you shouldn't take all of those meanings to be intended. And that's from the vastness, the eloquence of the Qur'an, that it contains multiple meanings in the same phrase. That's of the meanings of the Qur'an being Qur'anul Majid. Majid is expansive. It's expansive in its meanings, far beyond the number of the words. Okay? So say, I seek refuge in Allah. Allah here is called Rabbul Falaq, the Lord of daybreak and the Lord of the breaking of the sea. Both of those are meanings we said we can accept. So I seek refuge in Allah. Here's now the end result. What's supposed to come to mind when you say that? The one who breaks open the dark night with some brightness. And the one who breaks open the dead seed with some life out of the dead. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. See, much more than we first thought that it contains in that one ayah, right? Now, who am I seeking refuge in? Rabbul Falaq. What am I seeking refuge from? That's the next verse until the end of the surah. Min sharri ma khalaq. From the evil of that which He created. Some people translate the ayah as from the evil He created. And this is wrong. You shouldn't translate the verse like that. Even though literally you may think the verse is saying that. Min, from. Sharri, evil. Ma, that. Khalaq, He created. From evil, He created. Okay? But that's why you need to understand that a translation, I'm not going to go too deep into this, but the translation in reality is a tafsir, is an explanation, is an interpretation. And you're not interpreting the words, you're interpreting the meaning of the words. And that's why the interpretation is not Quran, it's the choice by which the interpreter chose to explain the words. They could be right, they could be wrong. Whereas Allah's words, as He intended them, those are always right. Got me? It's very important to keep that in mind. And I have examples that I don't want to use because we just want to keep it simple tonight after the beatdown that you guys received in yesterday's lecture. Okay, and I apologize for the 14th time. Why do I say you have to translate this as from the evil of what He created, of that which He created? Because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us in the hadith of Ali ibn Abi Talib in Sahih Muslim that when we enter salah, we make a certain dua. Of that dua is what? وَالشَّرُّ لَيْسَ إِلَيْكَ. And evil is not to be ascribed to you, O Allah. Evil is not ascribed to you. So we don't say that Allah created evil. So who created evil? Who created evil? You remember?
Allahu Akbar.
Jazakallahu khairan. There's no such thing as evil. So wait a minute, there's tons of evil in the world all around us. What do you mean there's no such thing as evil? Look at this. The disease and the shaitan and the killing, what do you mean? Allah does not allow for there to exist anything in His universe that is just evil, pure evil, meaning just harmful. That which you're calling evil, He did cause it to exist, but we don't agree that it's evil. There could be evil in it, but for a greater wisdom. You understand? And of the mandatory manners a believer has with Allah is that he does not say, "Oh Allah, you created this evil." Of course, there's no creator but Allah. Everything that exists, He created it. But I'm refusing to say this which He created is evil. Even if there may be some harm in it, even if there may be some evil in it, I ask Allah to protect me from that because He created it for a wisdom. Of that wisdom, just so we can be relevant, is so that you can rush back to Allah and seek protection from Him, with Him from that evil. You understand? But from manners with Allah, you don't ascribe evil to Him. You know, even the beautiful discussion of Ibrahim alayhi salam, when he's describing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he uses the same manners throughout the Quran. He says that my Lord is the one alladhi khalaqani, fahuwa yahdeen, the one who created me. He created me, and He is the one that guides me. Walladhi huwa yut'imuni wa yasqeen, and He is the one that gives me food and gives me drink. وَإِذَا مَرِضْتُ فَهُوَ يَشْفِينَ, and when I become sick, He doesn't say when He made me sick. Even though Allah is the one that destined it, but out of manners with Allah, you don't say the evil came from Him. That it's not pure evil. But because we look at sickness as pure evil, He didn't ascribe it to Allah. He said, Allah created me and He guides me. And He gives me food and He gives me drink. And when I become sick, notice the beauty of Ibrahim alayhi salam's words. That's why Allah captured them for us in the Quran. And when I become sick, He goes back to Him. He's the one that cures me. Likewise, the jinn. In the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about them what? وَأَنَّا لَا نَدْرِي أَشَرٌ أُرِيدَ بِمَنْ فِي الْأَرْضِ أَمْ أَرَادَ بِهِمْ رَبُّهُمْ رَشَدًا. And we don't know, we couldn't figure out, was there evil intended in passage? We don't know who's intending it, right? It's out of manner, but they're talking about evil. Was there shar intended for the people of the earth, or did their Lord wish well for them? The goodness is attributed to Allah. The evil is mentioned in the passive voice. So from the evil of what He created, meaning anything that He created, there could be an evil in it. And we need to ask Allah protection from it. But keep in mind something very important we need to keep in mind about this ayah. When you say of the evil of what He created, you're seeking refuge in Allah from that. You know what's the number one evil you need to keep in mind? The evil of yourself. How often our Prophet ﷺ said what? وَنَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنْ شُرُورِ أَنْفُسِنَا. We ask Allah, to give us refuge from the shurur, right? The shurur is the plural of shar. Min sharri ma khalaq, right? From the shar of our inner selves. Because that's the norm, that your inner self promotes evil. وَإِنَّ النَّفْسَ لَأَمَّارَةٌ بِالسُّوءِ. And indeed, this inner self, the nafs, is constantly provoking, promoting evil, except, there's only a small exception, the norm is like that, except those that my Lord has mercy on. So when you say, oh Allah, I seek your protection min sharri ma khalaq, from the evil of what you created, keep in mind, before anything, you say, oh Allah, protect me from the evil of me. The human being, so much wrong could come of him if he's left alone between him and himself. He panics really fast, right? And he's very, very greedy, right? And he's very insecure, except those that Allah has mercy on and gives them that guidance. Very simple. إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ خُلِقَ هَلُوعًا. Human being was created in a state where he's frantic. إِذَا مَسَّهُ شَرُّ جَزُوعًا. When evil hits him, he jumps. وَإِذَا مَسَّهُ الْخَيْرُ. Evil meaning harm. وَإِذَا مَسَّهُ الْخَيْرُ مَنُوعًا. And when good reaches him, he's greedy with it. So it's like either way, right? This is the norm. So مِن شَرِّ مَا خَلَقْ. Keep in mind that you're asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect you from the evil of you. But of course, of the evil of what he created includes you and all the other people and all the other shayateen and all the jinn and the animals and the crawling creatures, all of that. It's all intended in مِن شَرِّ مَا خَلَقْ, from the evil of what you created. Deal? Understood? Can I move on?
Yes, sir.
وَمِن شَرِّ غَاسِقٍ إِذَا وَقَبْ. And it's a continuation, and I seek protection you. And from the evil of Al-Ghasiq. Al-Ghasiq was interpreted by many, by most, as the night. إِذَا وَقَبْ. Once it becomes still, meaning when it settles, meaning when it becomes fully dark at night, and the night settles, and things stop stirring. So the dark, and I seek refuge in you from the darkness of the night once it arrives. There's also hadith the Prophet ﷺ pointed at the moon, and he said to Aisha radiallahu anha, this is al-ghasiq, when it arrives. And there's no difference really here, because the moon only really comes into full view at night. So the moon is a representative of the night. So it's almost interchangeable, these two opinions. So, O Allah, I'm seeking your protection from the evil of what you created and the evil of the darkness of the night when it arrives, right? وَمِن شَرِّ النَّفَّاثَاتِ فِي الْعُقَدِ. And I seek protection you from the evil of those that blow into the knots. Who are those that blow into the knots? Some ulama say that these are as-sahirat, the sorcerers. Because blowing into the knots is one of the ways that sihr, that sorcery is done. As it happened with the Prophet ﷺ, and I will discuss that in a bit, inshaAllah. And it was mentioned in the feminine, النفاثات, right? Because the majority of those that used to do this kind of sorcery were females. Other ulama said, النفاثات, those that blow into the knots, was feminine, because it's not talking about the people, it's talking about the nufus, the souls, and the souls are feminine in Arabic. And in that case, it will include the women and the men. So either way, we're seeking refuge in Allah from those that practice sorcery, whether evil or whether they're male or female. Those that practice this black magic is sorcery. And then the last ayah, وَمِن شَرِّ حَاسِدٍ إِذَا حَسَدٍ. And from the evil of al-hasid, the envier. The envier is the one that you know, enacts jealousy. The envier, إِذَا, when حَسَدَ, he envies. So what is hasad? What is envy? As most of the ulama describe, this is تَمَنِّي زَوَالَ النِّعْمَةِ, to wish that a person lose his blessing. That's what envy is, right? That's what hasad is. To see someone that Allah has favored with something and you wish that he loses it and that it comes to you, right? Or even if it doesn't come to you, at least he loses it. If I can't have it, nobody can. Right? So in essence, al-hasad, in its core value, this is, envy is, when a person hates to see others blessed. Long story short. Right? And notice that he, subhanahu wa ta'ala, said to us that we should say from the evil of the envier when he envies. Because there is a moment when envy becomes effective. Like envy is an act that can incur harm on people by Allah's permission. That when a person sees something, like the evil eyes, one of those practices that is done many times, not even deliberately. When you see a person that has a favorite, you hate that they have it. So this causes the soul to emit a certain projectile, only Allah knows the reality of it, and it causes a harmful effect to occur to that. The person has a car, the car breaks down, he bought some new land, you hit him with an evil eye, right? His land, whatever occurs to it, gets overrun by termites or something, whatever it may be. The Prophet ﷺ said, Al-Aynu Haqq, that the evil eye is a reality, it's a truth. Right? And he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَلَوْ أَنَّ أَمْرًا يَسْبِقُ الْقَدْرَ لَسَبَقَتْهُ الْعَيْنِ. If anything were going to outdo the qadr, the destiny of Allah, it would have been the evil eye. What does that mean? The evil eye doesn't outdo qadr. Because the evil eye is part of qadr, like everything else. Understand? But he's trying to say the same way destiny is effective, and wherever it takes place, the evil eye also, it has an effect. Even though that effect is part and parcel of what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala destined. And of course, these are of the matters of the ghayb, the matters of the unseen. Before I leave the surah, I want you to notice something very beautiful about these three things. I seek refuge in Allah from the evil that could exist in what He created. The nightfall when it arrives. The sorcerers when they blow. Right? When they perform their sorcery. And the envy of the envier. What do these three things have in common? Think, it's not random lists. Enjoy your Quran. What do they have in common? The knight, the sorcerer, the envy. All of these three things are hidden. The knight, by nature, by definition, conceals. And much evil occurs in the night. And our Prophet ﷺ taught us to take our children in the first part of the night especially, right? And many people hide under the wings of the night to perform their crimes, right? And much immorality happens in the night. This is when there's a factor of stealth and hiddenness is involved, right? Likewise, the sorcery. This is not noticed by almost anyone. This is a hidden harm that you can't notice. And likewise, envy. It comes from places you never expect. It's hidden. Sometimes the closest person to you, sometimes the most beloved person to you, could be the one that envies you. And that's why Ya'qub alayhi salam said to his son, لا تقصص رؤياك على إخوتك فيكيد لك كيدا. Don't tell your favor, this dream you had, this premonition to your brothers, or else they're going to plot against you. And so it's as if this surah is telling us, if we were to summarize it in a statement, that there is potential harm all around you, and you're stuck in the middle, and it's so much of it is hidden from you, and you're finished. How in the world do you fight all this off? It's almost a gloomy scene, right? Run to Allah, al-awd, right? Isti'adah. Come close to Him, because He's the one that brings the bright morning out of the night. Rabb al-Falaq. Isn't that beautiful? He is the one that brings life out of the Dead Sea. He cracks it open and pulls life out of the dead. He's the one that brings positivity out of negativity. He's the one that brings brightness out of darkness. Right? He is the one that brings opportunities out of despair. You know the beautiful hadith narrated by Ibn Majah, Abi Razin radiallahu ta'ala anhu narrated, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَضْحَكُ مِنْ قُنُوطِ عِبَادِهِ وَقُرْبِ غِيَرِهِ. Indeed, Allah laughs from his how his slaves get frustrated. Imagine this dark scene, how quick we do get frustrated. We don't know why bad things happen to us. From how quick his slaves get frustrated, despite how close his ghiyar and his taghir, despite how close his change is, I mean the relief that he can cause, the change he can bring out of nowhere, Allah laughs at the way his slaves get frustrated so fast when his relief is so close. Abu Razin radiallahu anhu, his hadith is authentic, said, Ya Rasulullah, أَيَضْحَكُ رَبُّنَا, our Lord laughs. The Prophet ﷺ said, yes, he does laugh. قَالَ لَن نَعْدِمَ مِن رَبٍ يَضْحَكُ خَيْرًا. He said, we will never then lose hope in a Lord that laughs. This is رَبُّ الْفَلَقِ, right? This is the Lord of daybreak. This is the Lord that brings life out of the dead. قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ الْفَلَقِ. Moving on to the next surah, inshaAllah, Azza wa Jal. Surah An-Nas, which is tied to it. But keep this theme in mind, that there is so much evil around us nowadays. So much harm, so much diseases, so much disappointment, right? Because the people have become distant from seeking help with Allah. They seek help with everything else before they seek with Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, Jalla Jalala. Because of the weak iman, that weak clinging, us not saying the likes of these surah, right? And if we say them, we don't know their meanings. And if we know their meanings, they're not present in mind and we do them. Surah An-Nas. قُلْ أَعُوذُ, we said these two already, right? بِرَبِّي, we said, Lord, Master, of An-Nas, of the people. Of course, Allah is the Lord and Master of everything, رَبُّ الْعَالَمِينَ. But He is the Lord of the people in this surah because it's speaking specifically about a specific harm that is specific to the people. مَلِكِ النَّاسِ, the King of the people. Meaning the one that has absolute mastery and absolute control over everything that happens to the people. Of course, to everything, but specifically the people. We need to keep that in mind. The wording prepares the heart to worship Allah correctly. إِلَهِ النَّاسِ. This is such a beautiful ayah. Allah is the Lord of the people. I mean the God, forgive me, إِلَهِ. رَبْ would be better, Lord, Master. إِلَهِ is the God worship. إِلَهِ النَّاسِ, the God of the people. The one that is adored by the people. You know the word إِلَه, God? It comes from the word وَلَهَ, right? And that means the one that is, وَلَهَ means to have an extreme attachment of the heart, right? So إِلَهِ النَّاسِ, meaning He is the one that is adored by the hearts. Because if you think about إِلَهِ النَّاسِ, if you want to translate it as the God of the people, of course you're going to have to, right? You're also going to have every ayah is going to have a paragraph, right? But wait, but Allah's not the God of all the people because not all the people worship Allah. They exist other than God. So why? How is He ilah al-nas? Deep down inside, everybody, when they get stuck, they throw all the fake ones out. They say, Ya Allah, right? There's no atheist on a sinking ship, they always say, right? And so He is ilah al-nas. Deep down inside, they know and they adore and they cling to Him. After now Allah, the Lord of the people, the King of the people, the God of the people, He says subhanahu wa ta'ala, مِن شَرِّ الْوَسْوَاسِ الْخَنَّاسِ, from the evil, we said that, of الْوَسْوَاسِ, the whisperer, الْخَنَّاسِ, the retreater. Who is the whisperer, the retreater? That's an easy one. Who is he? Shaytan, Rabbi, Satan, right? Iblis, Lucifer, whatever you want to call him, right? The bad guy, the really bad guy, right? Allah Azza wa Jal calls him here by two names. Al-Waswas, Al-Khannas. Al-Waswas, the whisperer. Why? Because he's constantly whispering. You don't get called a whisperer because you whispered once, right? But you're usually loud. You get called the loud guy, the obnoxious guy. But when you're called the whisperer, this tells you this is who he is. It's interchangeable, you can call him Shaytan or call him the Whisperer. He's just as identifiable by either of those. If a person wins one rugby game, hey Mr. Rugby, listen up, right? And he loses the next seven. Not you guys, I know, the season's starting tomorrow. Inshallah, no, you win all eight. You are called a loser, even though you won a game, right? Because you've lost them, that's the norm for you, that's the standard. Likewise, if you win all seven and lose one, you're a winner. Because that's the norm for you. Allah Azza wa Jalla is reminding Shaytan, that's what he does. That's what he's a pro at. He is the whisperer. That's all he can do. As the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Alhamdulillah alladhi radda kaydahu ila alwaswasa. All praise belongs to Allah who limited his plot, his strategy to whispering. And then the other, Al-Khannas. Al-Khannas means the retreater, the guy who's always running away. But if he's always whispering, then how's he always running away? Because that's his 24-hour shift. He's either whispering or running away. The moment he comes right back. He runs away and then he comes right back. Like the hadith that mentions the adhan, right? He hears the adhan, he runs away, he makes noise, he passes gas, wind, so he can, and then he comes back again as soon as the adhan is over. Then he qama, and then he comes back. So his whispers continue and he's constantly retreating to attack, guerrilla warfare. That's his job. That's what he does. He does not stop. Al-Hasan al-Basri rahimahullah, when he was asked, أَيَنَامُ إِبْلِيسِ قَالَ إِذًا لَوَجَدْنَا رَاحَةً. He was asked, does Iblis sleep? That if he slept, we'd find some rest. No, he's working, you're sleeping, even he's still working. Make sure he doesn't get up for fetches, right? Then you get up for fetches, get to the masjid first, so the people see you, mashallah, the first guy there. He's constantly working. Even when you do, he wants to ruin it. And ideally not to do it all. Just he'll get whatever he can get out of you, he'll get it. مِن شَرِّ الْوَسْوَاسِ الْخَنَّاسِ. Listen, wallahi, so beautiful. Wallahi, there's so much more to these ayat than what we first thought. الَّذِي يُوَسْوِسُ فِي صُدُورِ النَّاسِ. The one who whispers in the chests of mankind, of the nas, of the people. Notice some of the ulama said, he didn't say he whispers in the hearts of the people. Because he has no access to your heart. It's like Dracula, you have to let him in. The vampire can't come in by himself, you gotta invite him. Right? Shaitan is like that. He's sitting there in your chest, waiting for you to open a crack so he goes into your heart. He's just shooting from outside, hoping you'll open one window, you'll open one of those gates, so he can bring his army inside. He wants to sit in your heart. He wants it. That's what he wants from you. He wants nothing else. He wants your heart. الَّذِي يُوَسْوِسُ فِي صُدُورِ النَّاسِ. The one who whispers in the chests of the people. مِنَ الْجِنَّةِ وَالنَّاسِ. This shaitan, this whispering retreater that whispers in the chests of people, this one, he exists from jinn kind and humankind. So this shaitan, whispering, retreating in your chest, objective is your heart, he exists among humanity and among jinn kind. Among jinn kind, we know from the hadith. In Sahih Muslim, Sunan Tirmidhi, elsewhere, narrated by Anas radiallahu anhu, also the Hayy Umm Salama, he said to us sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that the shaitan flows through the pathways, the blood pathways of the son of Adam. Those are the jinn, obviously, right? No human being is swimming in it. Right? They're constantly in there, right? Trying to meddle and wreak havoc inside. Trying to sabotage your connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because once he has you off on the side, then it becomes a piece of cake. Because you're no match for shaitan. He's too good, he has too much experience, too great of a resume. But shaitan is no match for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, right? So he's constantly flowing, trying to find an inlet. As for humankind, whoever takes you away from Allah, through temptations, through confusion, shubuhat, shahawat, that is a shaitan. The one that does the job of shaitan for him. He whispers and retreats, attempts another attempt, he drags you away from Allah, Azza wa Jalla, Tabaraka wa Ta'ala. But keep in mind, there's something very beautiful as well, that this shaitan, whether he's jinn or whether he's human, whether he's a he or a she, all they do is whisper. And all they do is whisper and retreat, and all they can reach is your chest. You decide whose ideas, whose suggestions get inside. That's why what does that remind you of? That on the day of judgment, you can't blame anybody. You cannot blame anyone. To the degree that you work to increase your iman, to that degree, you killed your shaitan. It's your job. If you, increase that iman, the shaitan cannot survive. He cannot thrive in that atmosphere. You become, that heart becomes more and more impregnable. His whispers become lesser and lesser of a scream, less influential. And now, after I mention a bit of those two surahs, I want to call your attention to a few other beauties. How many ayat of Surah Al-Falaq? قل أعوذ برب الفلق من شر ما خلق من شر غاسق إذا وقب من شر النفاثات في العقد ومن شر حاسد إذا حسد. 5 ayat, 5 verses. سورة الناس قل أعوذ برب الناس ملك الناس إله الناس من شر الوسواس الخناس الذي يوسوس في صدور الناس من الجنة والناس. 6 verses. Okay, so which is longer? Who's the mathematician here? سورة الناس. Okay, the harm, the evil that we're seeking refuge with Allah from in Surah Al-Falaq is that mostly harm in this world or harm in the hereafter? When the bugs come out at night and the thieves come out at night, does that harm your dunya or your deen? Huh? Your dunya. When the sorcerers perform this sorcery, for the most part, unless you weaken your iman to let them into your heart, the most they can harm is your dunya. And I'll prove that in a minute. And what was the third again? And the envier. Once again, all he can envy is what? The dunya. For the most part, the envy affects dunya. The harm of shaitan, who's on a mission for your heart, his harm is where? Dunya or akhirah? Akhirah. What's longer? The harm that results in a harm in your hereafter or a harm in your dunya?
Akhirah.
Which surah is longer that protects you from the harm of the akhirah? Surah An-Nas. Isn't that beautiful? You understand the connection here? طيب. Why were these two surahs revealed? Two quick points and I'm done, inshallah. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was struck by a harm from a sorcerer from among the Jews of Medina whose name was Labid ibn al-Asim. Okay? He was able to get some of the hairs from the comb of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Okay? And they were tied in knots, and those that worked for him, those women, sorcerers, they blew into these knots, and this was buried in a well. And this, once again, I'm proving to you, the sorcery, for the most part, is dunya. Because the Prophet ﷺ's heart was filled with iman, there was no effect there. He was affected in his dunya, in that his worldly memory became a bit blemished. In that he became forgetting, did I go to this wife yesterday or that wife? His management of visitations was affected. Until Jibreel alayhi salam came to him and told him, the reason why you're going through this is because of X, Y, and Z, and the comb there, and the knots that were made are in that well. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to him 11 ayat. Surah Al-Falaq and Surah An-Nas. One for each of the 11 knots they made. And whenever he recited one of them, one of those knots was undone until he stood healthy and recovered sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. By the way, some people, not scholarly, but some people deny this hadith. The hadith is in Bukhari and Muslim, as I said. So it's the most authentic type of hadith, caliber of hadith, before mutawatir, right? Before a recurrent, an abundant recurrent, which is the highest form of sahih, authentic hadith. First of all, in Bukhari and Muslim. Second of all, why are you having a problem with the hadith? Like, why do you want to dismiss it? How did the Prophet ﷺ get affected by sorcery? What if he would have messed up with the message? No. Allah is not forgetful. And Allah would not have let that happen. And Allah said that he would protect this message. And therefore, he was touched in his humanness. But why? Even in his humanness, why? To prove that he was human. That's of the benefits, isn't it? To increase in his reward. That's of the benefit, isn't it? To teach us what to do when it happens to us. Isn't that a very important benefit? Right? So this was the reason for revelation. Another beautiful hadith, he said, last night, two verses, two chapters, surahs, were sent down upon me the likes of which have never come down in the Torah and the Injil and the Zabur. And they are, قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ الْفَلَقِ قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ النَّاسِ. This is a gift for this ummah. These vaccines, these medicines, this cure, this guidance. And lastly, know that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam used to be very attached to these two surahs, and he would recite them all the time, along with قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدٍ, as we said in the beginning of the lecture. He would recite them before the sun rose, and he would recite them before the sun set, and he would recite them according to some narrations after every salah with his dhikr, okay? And he would recite them into his hands, and blow spittle, right? Spittle is spitting without water, without wetness, into his hands 3 times and wipe them over his body, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and then do it again, do that whole process 3 times. Before he went to sleep, he would perform ruqya on himself. Right? So we should not take these things for granted. These are some of the most powerful tools on the face of the earth. And so much harm exists in dunya and in deen because we've steered away from the likes of these beautiful verses that bring our heart to cling to Allah. That's the meaning of isti'adha, from the evil of this world and the next. The harm of dunya and the harm of akhirah. You know? Many doctors nowadays, after they diagnose a disease, sometimes they can't diagnose it to begin with, right? And sometimes they diagnose it and still don't know the reason. The reason is the generations continue to get more and more distant from Allah. Even physical diseases. Didn't Ayyub alayhi salam say, رَبِّ إِنِّي مَسَّنِيَ الشَّيْطَانُ بِضُرٍ وَعَذَابٍ وَعَذَابٍ. He said, oh my Lord, shaytan has afflicted me with this affliction, this harm, and this torment that I'm going through. So shaitan is a factor, even in the physical illnesses. And that's the explanation that the physicians can't explain many a times. And even in the spiritual diseases as well. The power of the Qur'an, if you knew how to use, Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah has a beautiful statement when he's speaking about the most powerful person, the Qur'an al-Kursi. His ayat al-Kursi is like the most perfect sword, but if you don't know how to carry it, it's not going to benefit you. Right? With certainty. You know, Shaykh Wahid al-Salam Bali, who is the most prominent Shaykh, to my knowledge, in the world, that deals with spiritual ailments, people that have these issues with jinn and otherwise. And he has a very famous book, a beautiful book called Asar al-Mu'tah. It's available online. It is mentioned that a young Moroccan da'iya from Morocco had went to him and said to him, Shaykh, there's a lady in our village that what she does, she makes every single person come to her before marriage. And has to pay her a certain amount. So that she doesn't let the jinn harm him. So that he can perform on his wedding night. Physically perform. Right? So he wouldn't be impotent. He says, and I'm going to get married soon and I want to break her control of the people, the fear-mongering she has among the people. The con artist enterprise she has with the people once and for all. He says, listen, he told the young man, he said, Allah Azza wa Jalla says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُدَافِعُ عَنِ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. Allah protects the believers. You're a believer and you're spreading the sunnah of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. I want you to do the following. I want you to get up on the minbar in Jumu'ah, on the day you're getting married, and tell the people, I am getting married tonight and I'm not going to that imposter. And I want you to make sure you say your adhkar before sunrise and sunset. Make sure you say the ayat and the hadith the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam taught. These words, they are words, but the words of Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala, His words, the words He inspired, His message Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Make sure you say ayat al-Kursi. Make sure you say qul huwallahu ahad. Make sure you say qul a'udhu rabbil falaq. Make sure you say qul a'udhu rabbil nas. With a present heart. And Allah will use you for His deen. And He did that. And He had His wedding night with no complications and she was out of business. Right? We need to reintroduce ourselves to this book and, you know, reinsert confidence in his book and his words over anybody else's words. We have to do that. So, in his words, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Right? I'm going to end here, bi'idhnillah azza wa jal. Wa sallallahu ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Walhamdulillahi rabbil alamin. Jazakumullahu khairan.